Derivation of the gradient descent rule. How to calculate the direction of steepest descent along the error surface. The direction of steepest can be found by computing the derivative of E with respect to each component of the vector W. This means that we need to calculate how the total error capital E is changing with respect to any of the weight specified in the network. This vector derivative is called the gradient of capital E with respect to the vector W, that is weight W, and it is written as delta E of the weight vector W is equal to delta E with respect to weight W naught and delta E with respect to weight W1 and so on till delta E with respect to weight Wn. Notice that delta E of weight W is itself a vector whose components are the partial derivatives of total error capital E with respect to each of the weight Wi. When interpreted as a vector in weight space, the gradient specifies the direction that produces the steepest increase in the total error E. The negative of this vector therefore gives the direction of steepest decrease. The gradient specifies the direction of steepest increase of capital E. The training rule for gradient descent is written as weight W vector is equal to old value of weight plus delta W, where delta W vector, that is the second term in the above equation, is equal to minus neta into delta E of weight vector W. Here, neta is a positive constant called learning rate, which determines the step size in the gradient descent search. The negative sign is present because we want to move the weight vector in the direction that decreases capital E, means that we want to decrease the total error capital E. This training rule can also be written in its component form, that is Wi is equal to Wi plus delta Wi, where delta Wi is equal to minus neta into derivative of capital E with respect to weight wi. To calculate the gradient descent, we need to calculate the gradient at each step. The vector of delta E by delta wi derivatives that form the gradient can be obtained by differentiating capital E from equation 2, which we have seen earlier. Differentiation of capital E with respect to weight wi is equal to differentiation of summation of td minus od whole square with respect to wi. This is equal to, we will keep 1 by 2 and summation outside, the differentiation of td minus od whole square. This is equal to half of summation of the differentiation, turns out to be 2 into td minus od into differentiation of td minus od with respect to wi. Again, solving this differentiation, we will get summation of td minus od into minus x I comma d. This we call it as equation number 6. Substituting this equation into equation number 5 will yield the weight update rule for gradient descent. Finally, we will get delta wi is equal to neta of summation of, for all small d belonging to capital D, td minus od into xid. Gradient descent algorithm for training a linear unit. Gradient descent algorithm is stated as shown. The gradient descent consists of two parameters, that is training examples and neta. Each training example is a pair of the form x vector and t, where x vector is the vector of input values and t is the target output value. Neta is the learning rate. For example, neta can be taken as 0.05. Initialize each weight wi to some small random value until the termination condition is met. Do the following steps. Initialize each delta wi to 0 means new value of changed weight is 0. For each pair consisting of x and t in training example, that is input value and corresponding target value, do the following. Input the instance x to the unit and compute the output O. For each linear unit weight wi, do the following. calculate delta wi. That is, delta wi is equal to old value of the weight plus neta into t minus o into xi. For each linear unit weight wi, do the following. That is, calculate the new value of weight. New value of weight is equal to old value of weight plus delta wi. If we want to summarize the gradient descent algorithm, that look like this. Pick an initial random weight vector, apply the linear unit to all the training examples, then compute delta wi for each weight according to equation number 7, then update each weight wi by adding delta wi, then repeat this process. Features of gradient descent algorithm. Gradient descent is an important general paradigm for learning. It is a strategy for searching through a large or infinite hypothesis space that can be applied whenever the hypothesis space contains continuously parameterized hypothesis and the error can be differentiated with respect to these hypothesis parameters. The key practical difficulties in applying gradient descent are, first one, converging to a local minimum can sometimes be quite slow. Second one, if there are multiple local minima in the error space, then there is no guarantee that the procedure will find the global minimum. Stochastic approximation to gradient descent. Stochastic means that having a random probability distribution or pattern that may be analyzed statistically but may not be predicted precisely. The gradient descent training rule presented in equation 7, which we have seen earlier, computes weight updates after summing all the training examples in training space capital D. The idea behind stochastic gradient descent is to approximate this gradient descent search by updating weights incrementally following the calculation of the error for each individual example, that is, delta wi is equal to neta into bracket t minus o into xi, where t, o and xi are the target value unit output and ith input for the training example in question. One way to view this stochastic gradient descent is to consider a distinct error function ED for each individual training example D as follows. ED of the vector W is equal to half of TD minus OD whole square, where TD and OD are the target value and the unit output value for training example D. Unit output means it is the actual output obtained after calculation. Stochastic gradient descent iterates over the training examples D in the training example samples capital D. At each iteration, altering the weights according to the gradient with respect to ED. The sequence of these weight updates when iterated over all training examples provides a reasonable approximation to descending the gradient with respect to our original error function ED. By making the value of neta sufficiently small, stochastic gradient descent can be made to approximate true gradient descent arbitrarily closely. Let us see the differences between standard gradient descent and stochastic gradient descent. The standard gradient descent error is summed over all examples before updating the weights, whereas stochastic gradient descent weights are updated upon each training example. Means that in standard gradient descent, we are calculating the error for the entire network, whereas in stochastic gradient descent, we are calculating the error with respect to each training example. Standard gradient descent requires more computations per weight update step, whereas stochastic gradient descent requires less computation per weight update step. Standard gradient descent is often used with a large step size per weight update, whereas stochastic gradient descent is often used with a smaller step size per weight update. Both standard and stochastic gradient descent doesn't have multiple local minima. If at all, stochastic gradient descent has multiple local minima, then it will avoid falling into these local minima. We have considered two similar algorithms for iteratively learning perceptron weights. The key difference between these algorithms is that the perceptron training rule updates weights based on the error in the thresholded perceptron output, whereas the delta rule updates weights based on error in the unthresholded linear combination of inputs. The difference between these two training rules is reflected in different convergence properties. The perceptron training rule converges after a finite number of iterations to a hypothesis that perfectly classifies the training data, provided the training examples are linearly separable. The delta rule converges only asymptotically toward the minimum error hypothesis, possibly requiring unbounded time, but converges regardless of whether the training data are linearly separable or not. A third possible algorithm for learning the weight vector is linear programming. Linear programming is a general, efficient method for solving sets of linear inequalities. Notice each training example corresponds to an equality of the form W into X is greater than 0 or W into X is less than or equal to 0, and their solution is the desired weight vector. Unfortunately, this approach yields a solution that only the training examples are linearly separable. In any case, the approach of linear programming does not scale to training multilayer networks, which is our primary concern. In contrast, the gradient descent approach on which the delta rule is based can be easily extended to multilayer networks. Multilayer networks and the backpropagation algorithm. As we noted earlier, single perceptrons can only express linear decision surfaces. In contrast, the kind of multilayer networks learnt by backpropagation algorithm are capable of expressing a rich variety of non-linear decision surfaces. For example, a typical multilayer network and decision surface is shown in figure. Here, the speech recognition task involves distinguishing among 10 possible vowels, all spoken in the context of H and D, that is, the vowels starting with the letter H and ending with the letter D. For example, hid, had, head, hood, etc. The input speech signal is represented by two numerical parameters obtained from a spectral analysis of the sound, allowing us to easily visualize the decision surface over the two-dimensional instance space. As shown in the figure, it is possible for a multi-layer network to represent highly non-linear decision surfaces that are much more expressive than the linear decision surfaces of single units shown in the figure. A differentiable threshold unit. What type of unit shall we use as the basis for constructing multi-layer networks? At first, we are tempted to choose the linear units for which we have already derived a gradient descent learning rule. However, multiple layers of cascaded linear units still produce only linear functions, and we prefer networks capable of representing highly non-linear functions. The perceptron unit is another possible choice, but its discontinuous threshold makes it undifferentiable and hence unsuitable for gradient descent. What we need is a unit whose output is a non-linear function of its inputs, but whose output is also a differentiable function of its inputs. One solution is the sigmoid unit, a unit very much like a perceptron, but based on a smoothened differentiable threshold function. A sigmoid unit is shown in the figure. Like the perceptron, the sigmoid unit first computes a linear combination of its inputs, then applies a threshold to the result. In the case of sigmoid unit, the threshold output is continuous function of its input. The sigmoid unit computes its output O as O is equal to sigma of W into X, where sigma of Y is equal to 1 upon 1 plus e raised to minus Y. Sigma is often called the sigmoid function, or alternatively the logistic function. Note that its output ranges between 0 and 1, increasing monotonically with its input because it maps a very large input domain to a small range of outputs. It is often referred to as a squashing function of the unit. The sigmoid function has the useful property that its derivative is easily expressed in terms of its output. The gradient descent learning rule makes use of this derivative. Other differentiable functions with easily calculated derivatives are sometimes used in place of sigma. For example, the term e raised to minus y in the sigmoid function definition is sometimes replaced by e raised to minus k into y, where k is some positive constant that determines the steepness of the threshold. The function tan of h is also sometimes used in place of the sigmoid function. Let us know about the sigmoid function. Sigmoid function is normally used to refer specifically to the logistic function. It is also called as the logistic sigmoid function. All sigmoid functions have the property that they map the entire number line into a small range, such as between 0 and 1 or minus 1 and 1. So one use of sigmoid function is to convert a real value into the one that can be interpreted as a probability. The main reason why we use sigmoid function is because it exists between 0 and 1. Therefore, it is especially used for models where we have to predict the probability as an output. Since probability of anything exists only between the range of 0 and 1, sigmoid is the right choice. The function is differentiable. Sigmoid function produces similar results to step function in that the output is between 0 and 1. The curve crosses 0.5 at z is equal to 0 in the figure, which we can set up rules for the activation function, such as if the sigmoid neuron's output is larger than or equal to 0.5, its output is 1. If the output is smaller than 0.5, it outputs 0. Sigmoid function does not have a jerk in its curve. It is smooth and it has a very nice and simple derivative, like sigma z into 1 minus sigma z, which is differentiable everywhere on the curve. If z is very negative, then the output is approximately 0. If z is very positive, the output is approximately 1. But around z is equal to 0, where z is neither too large or too small, we have relatively more deviation as z changes.